Hey everyone, welcome to the Zelda Informer podcast. We are back for episode number 13, that unlucky number 13. And obviously today I have our co-host, as always, Mr. Alfred.
Hello.
And we have a special guest this week, one of the original members that started it all at Zelda Informer, Mr. Demir.
Hello. I feel flustered.
I thought about trying your last name, but I never can pronounce it right.
You're not the only one. I always get a good laugh out of foreigners trying to pronounce it.
Foreigners.
Yeah, you dirty foreigners. Hate you all.
Yeah, for those who don't know, Demir, I think, from Bosnia, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's why if you hear like a really thick accent in his English, that's because the native language isn't English, right?
Nope.
No.
Surprisingly, it's Bosnian.
See, I didn't even know there was a Bosnian language. Thought it'd be like German or something. Anyway, shows how much my total Americanness is coming out right now.
Yeah.
All right, so we're gonna get right into it. This week for our listeners, we won't be having any news or select topics because there really isn't a lot of big news happening right now. There's a lot of fan theories out there. A lot of crazy stuff people are thinking about for Breath of the Wild, but for us, it doesn't really matter because none of it's new information. So we're just going to go straight to fan topics because we have a ton of them this week. In fact, we have our first ever fan topic from our Google Plus account. Yes, we have a Google Plus account. It is from Jared Gaither. This is the topic he wants us to talk about. What do you think the dungeons will be like in Breath of the Wild? And then he makes two points to it. Will it be more traditional puzzles with linear progression or open-ended physics puzzles with many ways of completing them, kind of like how the shrines work, just longer? And which type of dungeon do we prefer for the game? Let's let our special guest jump in on this one.
Well, you know, the only information I really got from Breath of the Wild was the E3, since I'm really don't have that much time to keep up with the news and the fan theories, and you know, we all know how scarce Nintendo really is with the bits and pieces they give us. What I can't really say what it will be, since you know, I actually saw back when Breath of the Wild was announced, I saw two different interview answers from Reggie, I believe, who said that there won't be dungeons and that there will be dungeons. So we got conflicting information, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, there will be dungeons.
There will be dungeons. All right. So the point is, I am hoping they don't turn out, you know, the same as the shrines, but just longer. Because, you know, it's dungeons. You know, they're supposed to be more unique than that. And to tell you the truth, I did not like what we saw from the shrines all that much from the E3, because it was just, you know, the same thing over and over again. But, yeah, you know, I could be wrong. Once we actually get our hands on the game, might be the best part of it.
Sure. So, I got a question for you, Demir, on one of your things you said.
Sure.
But first off, in response to Jared, in talking about the shrines, because he talks about how it's like open-ended physics puzzles, as someone who was at E3 and played all four of the shrines many times that we were able to play, they're not really open-ended. There's one way to do everything. Like, it's not... it's not like when you're out in the world, you know how there's all these different ways you can take out the enemies, like you can blow them up, throw a rock at them, you know, whatever. That's not how the shrines that I experienced work. They all have, this is how you solve the puzzle, and that's it. There is no other alternative path. Just to clarify that with the user who asked, that's not how the shrines so far that I've seen work. Now, there's over 100 of them. So that's not to say all shrines work this way. This might just be the beginning area shrines where they're just teaching you how to use stuff. Which, again, the four shrines, you get four shrine abilities or four rune abilities. So it makes a lot of sense for them to be kind of linear. and not have a lot of variety to them. Now, Demir, you brought up that you thought the shrines were like the exact same thing.
Well, the aesthetic of them, you know, if
the aesthetic.
If there are hundreds of them and they all look that way, you know, it's going to get real old real fast.
Yeah, see, someone brought up before, you know, if we thought the aesthetic was for the shrines. I can't remember exactly what they said. It was something about if it's going to get boring.
No, it wasn't. Isn't bad. I mean, it's not a bad aesthetic. It's just hundreds of them. No thanks. I mean,
yeah. See, I'm of mind that they are really short for starters. They take like a few minutes to beat. So I guess I look at it as those shrines are kind of how do I put this?
Well, they are mini.
They kind of. Well, they kind of have to be all themed the same because they're all Sheikah shrines. Like, I guess to me, like, it makes sense for them to be themed the same just because of what they are. Like, we view them as, you know, little mini dungeons, but in game, like, the purpose for them existing is kind of like a place of worship for Sheikah.
Well, sure, but, you know, that does make sense, but then you're sacrificing enjoyment, you know, gameplay enjoyment for making a point, you know, for consistency. I mean, isn't the worst thing to sacrifice the gameplay for.
I think it's sacrificing visual enjoyment, because gameplay-wise, none of the shrines have played the same.
Well, yeah, that's why I was hesitant to say, you know, gameplay, you're sacrificing gameplay, but yeah, you're giving, you're risking them getting samey after a while for the sake of keeping a consistent tone. And sure. I really... You know, it wouldn't be that far of a stretch to say, all right, the Sheikah had two different, you know, there were Northern and Southern Sheikah, or, you know, something just to vary it up just a little bit. You know, one of the biggest qualms I had with, for example, Skyrim, is that all of the, literally, they just have one tile set for the dungeons, and it's the dungeons are the same.
Yeah. And like, obviously for the shrines, we don't know if this is what the aesthetic's going to be for all 100 of them. We have no idea. We've only seen, I think, 6 altogether if we count the Nintendo Treehouse footage. So we don't really honestly know. I mean, 6 out of 100 plus isn't much of a sample size to know. But getting more into what Gaither wants us to talk about, obviously, Demir mentioned he doesn't really want them to be, especially visually, like the shrines. Obviously, we don't know how many dungeons there are. There was that rumor before E3 that there would be 4 dungeons and 100-plus shrines. Obviously, so far, everything in that rumor has come true. We still don't know about the dungeons. But if there's 4 dungeons, 8 dungeons, 12 dungeons, whatever, I don't think aesthetically they're going to be like the shrines, because there's no reason for them to be. I think they're going to be more part of the world. Like shrines we've seen before where it's themed around a volcano themed around a forest. I think that's going to continue.
You mean dungeons?
What?
You said shrines. You mean dungeons?
Yeah, that's what the dungeons. Yeah. That's what I feel the dungeons are going to do. And then, in terms of how I would like to see them, you know, whether I'd like them to be open-ended physics puzzles, which Jared thinks the shrines are, but they're not, or if I want them to be more linear progression, which is actually what the shrines are. I'm kind of torn. I think it should be mixed. I think there should be dungeons that have multiple ways to progress through them based on how you want to progress. You know, whether it's the physics engine where you could do different things and use different items to progress or what have you. I think it would be good if there was some open-endedness to some of the dungeons. But I also think, you know, one or two of the dungeons maybe should fit a more traditional... You get your key... You need that key to progress to the next room. And that next room, you clear it out. You figure out what the puzzle is. You progress to the next room. That's kind of how a lot of dungeons have worked in Zelda in the past. And I almost think that it should be... there should be some of that. But I'm hoping that they do some more open-ended, more physics, more multiple item use ways of completing dungeons. Because if they're breaking all these conventions with the game, with the series so far, why stop at the dungeons? Like, why not do some new, fresh stuff with the dungeons as well?
Well, didn't they say that's gonna be seamless? And the thing they've been promising for the past three games, that the dungeons and the world are gonna blend in seamlessly, meaning there won't be a loading screen between the two.
That's not been stated officially. They were trying to do that with Skyward Sword, where like the land is kind of like a mini dungeon that leads into a dungeon. So like it felt organic. It really didn't end up working out that way, but that's what they were trying. With this game, they haven't said anything about dungeons at all, except that it exists. And they haven't really said anything about the world outside of the fact that it's open air, as they call it, aka open world.
Speaking of the world, there is one specific thing. I mean, it's a bit off topic for the dungeon speak, but one thing that they mentioned, they talked about, which is something worrisome, if you will, is the fact that I believe Reggie again mentioned it, that you can go to the final dungeon and fight Ganon straight off the bat. So just start the game.
Well, it's not start the game and go. Yeah, you have to do four shrines and get the parasail before you can do it.
But okay, yeah, that's
after the demo intro area. Then
yeah,
you can go.
Well, that means if that is true, let's assume it is. That means that nothing you do in the, I'm not sure how to phrase this properly, but point is that every single area, every single thing that you do in the different areas in the game has to be disconnected from one another. They can't affect each other. Because if you can just go and fight Ganondorf, then there's nothing you can do in the entire game, in the dungeons, in the shrines, that will affect you going to Ganondorf. You understand what I mean?
Yeah, no, I get what you're saying. I think how Nintendo phrased it in some interviews that Eiji Onoma did, that for starters, yes, you can go do that. He says you must be pretty crazy or you really, really like a super hard challenge. Mm-hmm. So obviously, the point would be, to explore and do the rest of the world would be, for that particular fight, to make it a little easier, to make yourself stronger, but and maybe even get items that don't break, like the Master Sword. I'm sure the Master Sword doesn't break. If it does, I'd be highly surprised. But
what I assume is... Oh, sorry.
No, it's okay. I think that they are... I think the way they phrase it is the reason to explore the world is while you can go to Ganondorf straight away if that's what you want, they want you... Or Ganon. We don't know the Ganondorf, that form, is in the game yet. But I think what they want is they want you to want to explore. They don't want to force you to do it. They want you to be like, look, I want to explore. Why was I asleep for 100 years? What happened? Like, you're not going to find that out if you go straight to Ganon. You're not going to find out what happened to Hyrule. Why is the Temple of Time in ruins? Why does it appear castle towns in ruins? What are all these guardians all over the place for? Why are these all these Sheikah shrines? What the heck happened to the Sheikah? Why is there like all these shrines with these little seemingly Sheikah related beings in them? Like what's happening? They basically want you to go learn more, not force you to have to go.
Yeah, I understand that.
It's kind of like Zelda 1 in a way, except Zelda 1 didn't let you do the last dungeon right away.
I think the clearest example of what that's like is if you play Far Cry 4, and the very beginning of the game, you get to the destination country, whatever it is, there's an Easter egg, quote-unquote, that's what it is. It's not like you could technically win the game this way, but it's not the way that they want you to play the game.
Sure.
If you wait for like 15 minutes on the dot, pretty much, Pagan Man, the bad guy, will show up, take you to the end of the game, where you don't have to fight anyone, you don't have to go explore the world. You could technically beat the game like that, but you don't want to, unless you're just getting that achievement. You wouldn't want to because, first of all, the game's $60, or it was when it came out. Same thing with Breath of the Wild. You wouldn't want to get a game for $60 and then only play it for like 5, 10 minutes, or 15 minutes in this case. Second, you miss so much story, so much backstory, so much lore to the game that... and I'm not saying that Far Cry 4 has a very compelling, deep story to it. That's really
it's
not
fun,
the...
though.
Yeah, it is, but that's not the draw of the game.
Yeah.
But you miss that stuff when you go straight to the end, and I think that that's what they're trying to say with this is that it's so open world that you can do, or open air, that you can go wherever you want, whenever you want, do whatever you want.
Yeah, no restrictions.
You, yeah, but you...
No, like, I think one thing that's always frustrated me with games in the past is no invisible walls. You can't go here. Sorry.
No Man's Sky.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, but...
Let's not talk about that.
I'm sorry, but you... That is a... Nate inadvertently displayed my point for me when you said, okay, find out this, find out that, if you want to find out. Sure, you can, but you can also skip it. And more importantly than skipping it, you can selectively find it out. And that's something they mentioned in an interview, that you can go anywhere and do anything, so it's open-ended, fine. Mm-hmm. However, what if I, you know, choose to go to region A instead of region B, and you go to region B instead of region A? We do them in inverse order. You know, that's fine. Okay, we can do it. But that means that the two regions, they can't be connected. They can't have any connecting story elements. Otherwise, you can't do them in any order.
Sure, you can.
They did that in Link Between Worlds, though, where you could go from random, like, any dungeon you wanted to, and the story still progressed the same way.
I think, in the past, this is actually an interesting point about story in Zelda games. And we do have someone who asks about some story stuff for Breath of the Wild later, so maybe this will inadvertently answer that topic. I think that in the past, a lot of story progression in Zelda has been built around dungeon progression. Like, you would go defeat Volvagia to help out the Gorons, and it would progress the story. Like, you would do these dungeons to progress story. Here, from what we have heard, a lot of the story stuff happens with the people and happens in the towns and is all optional. So when you go out to do it, you don't have to do these dungeons. There's going to be like a side quest or some compelling reason. Like, say, if you go to this dungeon and you go get this item, it prevents the town from being flooded. And maybe that's not a story progression reason to do the dungeon, but it gives you a compelling reason to want to do the dungeon to save those people, as an example. And I think that's what they're doing with the story in this game, is they're making it where, yeah, everyone can go off and do their different regions and get different parts of the story at different times, but it's not the progression of that story is built around your exploration rather than being built around a set path of beat this dungeon, then you get this cutscene, beat this dungeon, then you get this cutscene, which is traditionally what Zelda has done. Well, so I just think they're doing a different approach to story.
Well, you know, it's at the end of the day, it's, you know, a balance between the two things. If you make it all open ended, and you know, then again you have that risk. What I mentioned, the areas just aren't connected. You can't connect them by a story that goes across two regions if all the regions are separate.
All the regions aren't separate. They're all connected. The only region that's separate is the very starting region.
I meant, you know, not separate as in physically. I meant as in logically separate.
See, I think it's kind of hard to explain, because what Breath of the Wild is doing, and this is where, when people tell me that Breath of the Wild isn't unique, it isn't, it's nothing special, all these other games have done it, I don't think any game is doing what Breath of the Wild is attempting to do. And not just in terms of being an open-world action-adventure game. Like, yeah, okay, there's games out there that do it. There's RPGs that do it, like the Witcher series. But I think what they're doing is they're attempting this new way of telling a story that is going to end up alleviating the concerns that you have, but it's something that can't be explained, because there's no game that I can point to and be like, hey, this game did it, and it worked really well. Like, there isn't a game that's really tried doing this. They've all had their story, even like The Witcher 3, which is totally open world. You can skip towns, you can skip all this stuff. The story still works on a set linear path. And this game isn't doing that. It's like spreading everything out all over the whole world and saying, go find it if you want it, go figure it out. And how that's going to interconnect, how that's going to work region to region, is different. It's different than we've ever seen. Like, if I go to region B and you go to region A, you might find out part of the story, and I might find out a different part of the story, but I think based on how we went about that, as players, we're not going to realize that something is off, that something's not connected. Because when we go to the next area, I feel like everything's going to flow really naturally area to area, no matter which direction you go, even if you find out different parts of the backstory at different times. And it's something that I literally can't think of a game that's tried this before.
Well, like I said,
so I'm very curious.
With the Link Between Worlds, they did the same thing.
To do that, that's a whole different.
Yeah. I mean, again, we don't know. Obviously, they haven't told us anything about the story besides the beginning. So, but if this is what they're doing, which to me, I think it'd almost be revolutionary for open world games to do it this way.
Well, you know,
I don't know. Again, we don't know, but this is what I think is going to happen with the story, anyways.
Well, I sincerely hope you're right, to tell you the truth, because that would be something
that would be awesome.
A breath of fresh air, wild breath of fresh air for the open world.
And it makes the game like infinitely replayable.
In theory,
in theory, it being so open world is like if I want to go right through and see what the final cutscene is, I can go do that right away. And then I'm like, okay, well that felt unfulfilling because I didn't know what else happened. So then I'm gonna turn around and go explore, and then do this and do that, and then say you're in this area like. Just an area in the game you really don't like. Oh man, I hate the desert. This sucks. This is boring. Well, screw it. I'm skipping it. I don't need to be here. So we'll see. We'll see kind of how that all works. Jared, thank you for your question. I know we got way off topic. Start talking about the story.
Just a little bit.
But I hope we kind of gave you an idea of some potential dungeon stuff. I know we didn't talk much about dungeons there, but that's okay.
Well, I mean,
I can tell Demir wants to talk about Breath of the Wild because he doesn't work at a Zelda site anymore, so he doesn't get to do this all the time.
Well, no, I mean, it all loops back. I mean, it's...
Sure.
Really, at the end of the day, the dungeons are dependent on the story, and vice versa.
Traditionally. We don't know they're dependent on.
No, I mean, even in Breath of the Wild, these... how they do the dungeons will eventually depend on how they do the story and the rest of the game.
Yeah. And I think it all depends. Personally for me, just like, I guess the last point on dungeons for what's his name? Jared? Yeah, Jared. Is that I would like to see, like, the point of going to a dungeon. It's always been about progressing story. I would like for it to be something more like, it's not about progressing something more so as it is, I hear about this. I hear about this ancient Sheikah technology, like the the myths in the past where you could dig into the ground. That lets me tunnel into the ground and do some cool stuff. I don't need the item for any possible reason except just it's cool and I really, really, really want to try it out. And I keep hearing about it. People keep telling this legend about blah, 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 blah. And that's what makes me want to go get the item, is just people talking about it. And that item just happens to be something you have to go to a dungeon to get. I'm not going to that dungeon to save people. I'm not going to that dungeon to do anything except me wanting to go to that dungeon to get something out of it. And I think that would also be an interesting way to approach at least getting people into dungeons. Again, these are just ideas. We have no idea. Nintendo, give us more. Like, Demir, you were talking about how, I haven't kept up with it since E3. There's been nothing since E3.
Well, yeah, that's why I haven't. I actually said that. You know, Nintendo is, we all know how they are with giving out information.
Yeah.
I mean, the NX is supposed to come out in 6 months, and we literally don't know anything about it.
Yeah. We're going to move on, because we have a lot of topics. We spent a long time on that one. This comes from our this comes from our YouTube page, our second ever fan topic from YouTube. The Bread Pirate Roberts wants to know what other environmental things do we think will be able to be affected besides trees, rocks, and grass in Breath of the Wild. We do know some things. I'll let Alfred kind of take this one a little bit.
So is this what we think or what we'd like to happen?
I would probably state stuff that we know gets affected besides what he mentioned, and then if there's other, what things we think might. Yeah, like what we think instead of what we want.
Well, you go ahead and list off what we know.
Okay. So he mentioned trees, rocks, grass. The barrels are affected by physics. The chests are affected by physics. Pretty much anything you can interact with is affected by the physics engine. So with the weapons, the enemies, everything is affected by physics in that way. I don't really have anything else. Based on what I played, I can't even think of anything else I want to be affected by physics. There might be some cool things I hope we can do. I mean, heck, you can make a catapult and throw Link in the air and die if you want.
Has anyone ever confirmed if, you know, that thing when you stop time and you just hit the boulder until it flies off real fast? Can you do that and then grab the boulder and use that for a kind of quick travel to launch yourself off the ground?
Yep.
You can do that?
Yep.
Oh, awesome.
It's very hard to do, and you're probably going to die, but but you can do. Like, there's a way, you can, like, make yourself levitate, too. Mm-hmm. If you set up, like, a metal box or, I can't remember, a metal beam or whatever, and then you stand on whichever other one, and then, like, you make it float in the air, and you can kind of levitate over things. And people were talking about ways that they could maybe use that to, instead of, like, building a bridge to go across the cold water, you could levitate across the cold water like you're Jesus or something. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of cool things with this system, and I think we've barely touched the tip of it because we've, you know, everyone's only had, like, a half hour worth of demo time to play around, so... Alfred, you got any ideas for the physics engine? Or environmental things for the
physics engine? I was thinking environmental things, but based on what we've seen, I haven't seen a lot of stuff like, you know, like in the real world, if you threw a bomb at the ground and it exploded, there'd be a significant dent in the ground. But we're not, I haven't seen that in any of the trailers where there have been bombs thrown. So we know that that's like the ground in that aspect won't be environmentally affected by what you do.
I think some things for the environment that, now that I'm thinking about it, I would like there to be more destructible environment.
Yeah, no, that's what I want, but that's what I'm not seeing in the trailer.
Yeah, like I when I played, you know, you say you'd like bomb a group of Vocablins, and one of them's up in a tower shooting arrows, it would not destroy the tower. It wouldn't do any damage to the tower. And that, comparatively to the rest of the world and how you can light grass on fire and wind affects it, like, it felt really weird that you can't do that. In fact, I don't even think trees can be lit on fire. I've seen people try to do it, but I've never seen a tree actually light on fire. And that's another environmental thing that you could chop it down, you can climb it, why can't I light it on fire like I can everything else?
I mean, maybe because it's a resource and they don't want
you to
lose it.
And grass isn't really a resource for anyone.
Yeah. I mean, but, you take that for what you will, because even in Minecraft you could set trees on fire, but it wouldn't burn the wood.
Well, then they need to think about the actual processing power. Simulate all of that.
Sure.
Which is going to be terrible.
So maybe that's something we could look for in the future, because Eiji Onomo did confirm a little while ago that there is going to be another Zelda game on the NX, whatever that ends up being.
Hyrule Warriors 2.
He did talk about how he does probably want to do another game like Breath of the Wild with the open world and everything. So we'll see. Maybe that's a future progression thing they'll do. But based on what I've seen, I don't think there's going to be anything unexpected environmental-wise that we haven't seen. There'll be, you know, really cool things I talked about, like levitation, the fast travel with the stasis ability, but, you know, the catapulting up in the air. But that's just all stuff you can already interact with, and we already know you can interact with. There's things that, destructible environments are really it for what I would like to see added. Mm-hmm. And they're not going to do that. I mean, even, what is it, Crackdown 3 coming out, whenever it comes out, that has destructible environments, like everything you can break, and that uses like an online, you know, cloud system to be able to process everything.
Well, I mean, and technically, No Man's Sky does too, for all its faults. You can actually blow holes in the ground. Mm-hmm. And that cloud, that saves onto whatever server that they have where you can go visit another planet.
Supposedly there's multiplayer, but then there's
supposedly
not.
There's a lot of things in that game. Supposedly I haven't found any of them.
Yeah, right.
But
it
I'd
exists.
Like to see,
no, we never said it exists. Oh,
I'd like to see, like you said, environments, like destructible environments, because that's always been something cool. Like when they brought that into the Injustice games or like Mortal Kombat stuff, that they use it like that. Mm-hmm. I've always thought that was pretty cool. And, you know, it always feels like a little less lifelike whenever you're in a game and you hit a barrel or you hit a tree or something and it doesn't break or glass doesn't break even though you
Yeah.
shot it with a gun. It just kind of takes some of the immersion out of the game.
It does. And with Breath of the Wild in specific, it does so many really good things with its physics engine that it does feel like destructible environments not being there kind of breaks it even more because so much of it, so much things are affected that it makes the stuff that doesn't get affected stand out a lot. But again, though, obviously we do have to consider the Wii U has its limitations. It's not, I never expected destructible environments. But it is something I hope that in the future they figure out how to do. I'm already really impressed with what they have, but I hope that was a good enough response for you, Mr. The Bread Pirate Roberts.
Again, great name.
Very awesome name. So the rest of these come from Facebook. We didn't really get anything useful on Twitter.
Not
So
surprising.
Brian, what?
Not surprising.
Actually, we have a pretty good fan base on Twitter. They're usually really responsive, but the only response we got is something I'm going to bring up towards the end, and it's not really a topic. It's more of a follow-up to an old story. So Brianna Pendarvis wants to know what we think are is the best final battle in a Zelda game.
Whew. Has to be
I think
final.
Nate and I can agree on this one.
Yeah, it says final battle. So I'm assuming the big baddie at the end. So,
So
what's your favorite one, Demir?
Well, I'm honestly torn between three. It's either the Twilight Princess Ganondorf, because I love long fights, and that had four stages. I loved
Yep.
that. But the Skyward Sword demise fight was
Yeah.
also, the music at the end, it just gave so much to it. And perhaps surprisingly for some, there's the Manus fight from Spirit Tracks.
Oh yeah, Maladus, yep.
Maladus, yeah, not Manus. Where's Manus from? I'm
I don't remember.
what game's that from? I confused it or something.
It's okay. I was gonna say you recorded our boss footage for that fight, so you
Yeah,
should
I
know.
know. I played through the whole of Spirit Tracks, and it was just amazing.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm just a heads up. I'm playing this Overwatch hero who talks, and I don't have a camera, and I suck so much since I can't concentrate properly. It's just so horrible.
That's okay. I suck when I can concentrate, so. Thank God that we didn't have a tie. Like, had to do an Overwatch match for our tiebreaker, Alfred. You would have destroyed me.
Woo! Dang it.
We'll have to keep that in mind for next time, though. Maybe I'll get better. Maybe I'll get worse. I have no idea.
Yes, tell me the work on it too.
I haven't even done one ranked match yet, so. I've been
It doesn't
afraid.
matter anymore right now, so you're good.
Yeah, I'm afraid. Alfred, what's your favorite final battle?
Okay, so I'm having trouble with mine too because there's three that I really like. I really like the demise boss battle and everything leading up to that, because the Horde battle was probably one of the cooler parts of that game,
Sure.
where you're literally slashing your way through enemies to try to get to Zelda. And then I've said this before, I really loved the horseback fight in Twilight Princess. Like, specifically that part was one of my favorite parts of that game. But I think the one that, like, I really, really liked the best was the Ganondorf fight in Wind Waker, because it felt like a I'm not like a living, breathing sword fight, not like demises, but like, you could counter, you could, like, the whole environment just felt like awesome, and then the music was awesome. I just love that boss fight so much, even though I sometimes suck at it. But that's probably my favorite one is Wind Waker, so I'd probably go like Wind Waker, Demise, and
Oh yeah,
Twilight, or
Wind Waker.
Skyward
Forgot
Sword, then
about that.
Twilight Princess.
Yeah, Wind Waker is awesome, especially with the double sword fight, stab at the head, the puppets. It's
Yeah.
a really fun fight. I'm torn too. This is a very difficult question because there's 18 Zelda games to date, and that means there's 18, final battles. And when you love the series so much, it's really hard just to pick one. Yet, if you ask me my favorite Zelda game, it's easier for me to pick that than my favorite battle.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe because, you know, my favorite Zelda game is pretty well known by now, so it might not be surprising. One of the games I think has one of the best final battles is Zelda 2.
Dark Link. Yeah.
Like, everything about that, because, you know, at the time, Dark Link was never even a concept, so, like, you had no idea, and you get to the end, you think you're going to be fighting Ganon or, you know, a minion of his, if not Ganon, and you end up having to defeat yourself.
I mean,
and, like, there's a lot of symbolism with that.
Mm-hmm.
And the fight itself, because, like, Dark Link's basically better at Zelda 2 than you are.
I think a lot of people are
better.
No matter
how awesome you are,
game than
like,
I am.
You are probably going to go to the corner, crouch down, and cheat to win. Like, or cheese to win. I shouldn't say cheat. So it's just a lot of lead up to it. I love the combat in the game anyways. And so to fight someone that has all the same moves you do, does them probably more precise than you can do them. And the symbolism behind the fact that in order to save Zelda, you need to overcome yourself is just really awesome. Another one that I'm surprised hasn't been brought up is the final fight with Majora in Majora's Mask.
See, I was going to say that, but it's so easy to just beat that with the Fierce Deity Mask.
Yeah.
It is. But see,
I love that fight. Don't get me wrong.
No. Yeah, because...
But I always 100% that game, and I always end up with the Fierce Deity Mask.
See, I've never 100% Majora's Mask, so... I've never actually fought him with the Fierce Deity Mask. Call me a noob for never doing it. I have a long story behind what used to happen with my old Majora's Mask cartridge. Anyways, to me, it's hard for me to be like, the fight is not that challenging because of this. I don't think any of the final fights are challenging besides Zelda 2. I think they're all easy.
Well, perhaps you're right, but... In Skyward Sword, you never really had to parry before the demise fight. So I never did it. I never parried in the whole game.
You don't really have to parry. In that fight, you could just back away from him the whole time and then wait for the lightning to hit your sword and then just kill him that way.
Yeah, but I didn't know about the
I didn't know about it either.
Lightning sword either.
Yeah, I didn't know about it either. Like, the first time I fought him, I actually did die the first time.
I died like 5-6 times.
It was the only time I ever died in my first playthrough of Skyward Sword was that fight, the very first time. I thought it was... Demise is an awesome fight. Like, any fight that ends with, like, a sword battle always feels, like, epic to me.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, once I realized how the mechanics of that fight work, it really wasn't that hard. So... I mean, and that's kind of how I feel with... the only fight that's remained hard over the years, even when you know the mechanics, is like the one in Zelda 2, but that's not why it's my favorite fight. It's more the symbolism behind that fight that makes it my favorite. With Majora, I think it's just, you know, throughout the whole time you're playing Majora's Mask, you hear about the mask, you hear about Skull Kid, but everything seems to be about Skull Kid, like learning what happened to Skull Kid, all this stuff, and all of a sudden... The big baddie, actually, like, you actually fight Majora. Like, this is the being that's actually behind all the evil. And it's, like, unlike in, like, Twilight Princess, where Ganondorf kind of jacks the story, Majora is actually there the whole time, whether or not you realize it. And it's just a really cool... really cool build-up, the multiple forms in the fight. Obviously, it was more challenging for me because I wasn't Fierce Deity. Still wasn't that difficult. If I'm ranking for difficulty, then Zelda 2 takes it by a long shot. And then probably Oracle of Ages.
One of the reasons why I dislike the demise fight is the fact that it's all the same. You know, even the first and second phase are virtually identical with just a small gimmick of a difference.
Sure.
And that's one thing. And actually, Melodus was very difficult. You know, the last phase of that fight actually took me, you know, 3-4 tries to get right.
Yeah, I see. The thing is, I know your first playthrough of that was on emulator.
Mm.
Um, So I wonder if that made it harder for you than it was.
It actually made it simpler because it was, since I was recording, it was all slowed down.
Yeah, see, I didn't die on that fight. But again, you know, there's also going to be different skill levels between us two when we play. What we're good at, what we're bad at. There's things I'm terrible at in Zelda. As an example, in Spirit Tracks, you know that puzzle where, like, you're in the tower and, like, you have to stand on one switch and then get them over here and then shoot an arrow?
Yeah.
It took me, like, an hour and a half to figure that out. Like, that's it's happened. So stupid. When I realized it, I'm like, oh, my God, really? So moving on. Thanks for your question.
Along with that, I kind of want to just pose, like, a short question.
Sure.
What's your favorite mini-boss in a Zelda game?
Oh, boy.
That's even more difficult. Can't remember
that
them
is
all.
Very difficult. Oh, boy. See, the thing is, you know, I'm having a hard time thinking of all the mini-bosses there even are. So pretty much should be whichever one I remember must be my favorite.
That's the exact same line of thinking that I've been going through.
So, like, I'm trying to think. A lot of bosses I'm thinking of are the final boss. What's my favorite mini? Can I even remember one mini boss right now? Am I really drawing a blank? Mini bosses are huge. They're in like every game.
I can remember is the Goron in Twilight Princess. You know, that one that you have to fight in the middle of the fire dungeon. That's one I remember.
And see, now that you mentioned, I remember it, but it wasn't memorable to me. That's why I'm not thinking of that one. There, maybe when I, kind of, maybe in Skyward Sword, there's that one dungeon where you fight, like, kind of two Skurvo kind of enemies.
Yeah, yeah.
I loved the initial fight with Skurvo, so, like, fighting two of them at once, like, that was just awesome to me. And I loved the combat in that game, so... the fact that that's the only one I could think of, that probably means it's my favorite, since it's...
Well, that was a really good one. So I'm not gonna
like that one stuck with me. Like I almost like that one better than the final fight in that dungeon. So
see this one for me. The answer to this one, it's like slightly kind of like yours for the final boss because Majora's Mask is my favorite Zelda game, and so I love how like I love the emotions in the game. I love the story of the game, and so boss fights like. Ego's Do Ikana, and like the Garo Master, or even like Captain Kida, those are really cool to me. And I don't necessarily remember the fights themselves, even though it was pretty cool to fight Captain Kida.
Sure.
I remember like the emotions and the characters, like
the feelings,
after you beat Ikana's king, like there's that whole dialogue and like talking about why their kingdom fell. Like, I like that.
Oh,
so that, for me, that's, like,
lots,
one of my favorite
lots of backstory.
Yeah.
I like that one a lot, too, now that you mention it. But I still like the Skyward Sword one better.
Yeah, definitely.
All right, well, thanks, Brianna, for that topic. Moving on, Tunker Gungordu. So we finally have our first non-Zelda-specific part of the topic. They want to know if we think Nintendo is going to show off the NX with a Nintendo Direct or a live press conference.
Probably Nintendo Direct.
Yeah.
Just because it's the less obvious answer.
I think it's almost the more obvious answer.
Yeah.
They do everything through digital stuff.
Actually,
now.
I mean, saying that less obvious is a bit wrong. What I meant is, what would a normal company do, and then
what would everyone else do? Nintendo's doing the opposite.
Yeah.
I think they're going to do. A live event, but it won't be like a press conference where they invite a whole bunch of media to it. I think it's going to be something like they go to Nintendo New York and they like block off the street and they kind of do like what they did for like the Wii U launch party where they blocked off the street. And it's just a live thing with Reggie on a small stage talking about the NX and unveiling what it is. And then as we're watching that online where we think, oh, this is a nice live thing. Like, right after they're done with their little spiel to that public, it's going to cut away and kind of just go do a bunch of trailers and a bunch of digital only stuff. Like, I think they're going to kind of combine the both. Where it's not really a press conference, but there's a live aspect to it to try to build hype.
Allow me to suggest a third option. They don't announce it. It just appears in stores one day.
I'm going to keep this myself. My favorite thing in the past week is actually something related to that. What do you think, Alfred?
I want to believe that they do a live event, but the problem
I want the live press conference.
Well, the problem is I don't, like, I think we'd know about it by now. We'd know that there was a live event because they'd be moving resources around. There'd be a place planning for it.
Yeah, leaked. If nothing else, it would leak out that, like, they rented a building out.
Well, it'd be like, okay, well, at Nintendo New York, or Nintendo World New York, we're going to rent out the building and we're going to hold the event there. Somebody would leak that.
I don't think someone would leak that. I think of it more akin to E3. Heading into E3, we knew that they had a theater rented out, and they ended up using it for like private meetings and stuff.
Yeah.
But that's stuff that comes out because when they rent a building, it's public knowledge. Like Nintendo New York, they already own Nintendo New York, so they can actually kind of keep that under wraps because that's all internal. They don't have to like call a landlord and be like, "Hey, we're doing this." The only thing they'd have to organize it with would be city officials in terms of, like, renting out the street.
Yeah.
And city officials usually don't leak this kind of stuff out.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not saying, like, a city official. I'm saying that there'd be, like, somehow, some way, it would get leaked. A
rogue Nintendo employee?
Well, like, you never know. Like, somehow it would be leaked. We'd learn that they'd rented some building out, or we'd learn that there was an event.
Well, and that also presumes that this event's coming up soon. We don't know.
Well, but we know that it's coming up within the next 2 months. Yeah.
They said this year. Rumors are suggesting next month, but we really have no idea. Yeah, I don't know if Nintendo knows.
The thing is coming out in less than 6 months.
I know. Isn't that crazy?
It's kind of high time for them to at least tell us what this is actually going to be called.
The only reason I can see them not doing it is if they've already decided to delay it, and they're just not telling us yet.
See, I still think that they're going to do Nintendo Direct because that's one. It's safer for them.
I think that's what
them.
They're going to do.
Yeah,
I don't want them to do it.
Well, but they're going to. I can't see them not doing it. I'll be very surprised if they don't do a Nintendo Direct for this event, because that way, like. There's pros and cons to a Nintendo Direct, but one of the pros that they have is that they can control the time. I'm pretty sure they don't film all those in one take, so there's no room for error.
Have mistakes.
Yeah, so they can just like shovel out the best version of each scene, each take that they have, along with the trailer for whatever it is, and they put that out, release like all trailers individually on YouTube, like they typically do.
Yeah.
Broken up. I mean, it wouldn't be bad. It wouldn't be the worst move for them to make. They'd probably, there's no guarantee that a live event would make them any money, or would make it do any better. But
and there's I think there's a couple things to look at here. EA's Peter Moore actually recently said that he thinks press conferences are on the way out, anyways. And not just like E3, like in general, like. Companies are just going to do digital event type stuff because it's cheaper and easier to control. I think probably I'm okay if there's a digital event. I think the reason I like the live event is it means that the people that are at the event, even though I probably won't be at it, but anyone who's at the event usually gets to go hands-on with whatever was announced.
Yeah.
And if there's no live event, there's no guarantee that people are going to be able to go hands-on with the NX. They might. Maybe they'll, maybe they will be able to go hands on with NX at a private, separate event from it. But I don't know. It's kind of one of those. I don't know. I go back and I keep watching that E3 2004 footage when they unveiled Twilight Princess. I go back and I watch. Was it 2005 when they unveiled the Wii?
Yeah, 6. I believe.
No, 6 was when they unveiled the controller.
Ah.
They announced the console in 2005. Anyways, when they announced it, and he like pulls the console out of his shirt. It's like, those moments
yeah.
are awesome.
Yeah, you can't have that in a digital
and it just doesn't, I mean, if he pulls it out of his shirt in a digital, whatever, it's all staged. You, like, there's no pressure here. There's no crowd. You know, and, you don't have to have to worry about him dropping the console.
That's where you lose a lot of like, hype, too, is if there's no crowd because you can't gauge fan reactions. Yeah, well, so...
They get Big Bang Theory it. Put some fake cheers in.
I hate that show. Don't even get me started on that show.
All right, moving on, because we have about 5 minutes left here on the topics. Here's another fun one. Kobe and Francisco, he asked us what Zelda had the best storyline.
Majora's Mask.
Majora's Mask. Ooh. Yeah.
Oh, look at that.
Next.
Man, am I going to be the one who disagrees? I
mean, you're going to have to sync that up.
Okay, I'll disagree with myself. I mean, I won't really, but just, you know, play the devil's advocate. There is one scene which kind of has, you know, puts Majora's Mask hold on the title a bit weaker. I mean, a lot of people have gripes with Scabbard Sword, but the scene when you wake up Zelda, that's epic. You know, that's one of the most beautiful things in a Zelda game ever.
And when Fee goes back to the rest. Yeah.
I think, Majora's Mask is...
See, the thing about that game is it's not just one narrative. It's several dozen narratives, like, interwoven together to create
like,
a story.
When I keep thinking about the main storyline in it, it's full of plot holes galore. But the thing is, like, unlike other Zelda games that just have plot holes to have them, it almost feels like the plot holes in Majora's Mask are intentional, and it works within the mystery surrounding Majora, surrounding Skull Kid, surrounding Termina. Like, it's almost as if everything is mysterious, and because everything's mysterious, those plot holes make sense to exist. So, like, the story is really deep. It deals with death more than any other Zelda game does. There's a lot of, obviously, you know, interpersonal reactions, you know, love stories and all that stuff. You know, you got the daughter and her father who's a mummy. You got, you know, that was Angie, I can't remember mispronounce
Andrew
it. Anyways,
Cafe, yeah.
Yeah, Andrew and Cafe, yeah. So, like, there's a lot of really good story elements, and Skull Kid's backstory is just amazing. But, yeah, I kept thinking, like, my problem, I guess, with Majora's Mask story... Is that really has nothing to do with Link at all?
Mm-mm. Well, it's not really
it
like...
Does. It does, come on. You know, you're wrong. I mean, I have to... It is. The whole thing's about Link. The whole thing's
not
about
Zelda.
Link. Well, it is about Link. It's about Link's inability to accept that Navi's gone. And that's the whole point of the story. But, you know...
He goes back and... He continues his journey to find her after.
No, he goes back to Zelda. He remembers that there's this flashback at the very end where he remembers that Zelda told him, "I'll be waiting for you." The whole point is some friends go, other people stay. Even if people leave your life, there will be others who are still there. And the whole point of the five areas, you know, the five areas symbolizing the five stages of grief, you know, anger, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance, you know, all five areas, you can follow that through the five regions of Termina. It all comes back to Link.
we're gonna cut short right there.
Yeah,
just saying.
Because like the five stages of grief have also been debunked by Eiji Aonuma himself, let alone by fans. So like, I'm just gonna the whole mystery around like a lot of the stuff that's put into Majora's Mask has to do with the stuff that's unexplained and the fans filling the holes.
But let's just talk about the fact that this Zelda game
you're
has
have
aliens.
You force me
on
that. I know.
Like you, trust me. The people who believe very strongly in it hate whenever I bring up Ijinoma's quotes and
you'll have
the
to
other
show
fan,
those
the other evidence. Yeah, we'll show you that after the podcast.
Nate, there are aliens in this game. Okay?
Yeah, there are aliens in this game. So for me, the favorite story, as Demir kind of brought up, is Skyward Sword for me. It's not just the one scene. To me, it's the whole thing. Mostly because this is the first time, I guess, a lot of Zelda games have something going on with Link, where Link's important, he's the hero, he's the chosen one. And a lot of reasons, that's why I like the Wind Waker, because in the Wind Waker, it doesn't necessarily feel like he's chosen so much as he earns the right to be the one. But in Skyward Sword, the game really feels like it's about him and it's about Zelda. Other games feel like, oh, Zelda's captured, go save her.
It's about Bruce.
Or you're kind of like forced into doing things that you don't want to do. But in Skyward Sword, it makes sense why you're going after Zelda. Because basically, she's her girlfriend. That's how the game plays it out at the beginning.
I'd ship it.
And, you know, so, yeah, exactly. So, like, you know, in the Bruce's story progression, the progression of Zelda in that game is just masterful. It is probably the best version of Zelda.
It's legendary. Opinion. It's like a legend of Zelda.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't require reading a manual like the old legend used to be for Legend of Zelda.
Well, it doesn't stop the game from having a two-hour manual at the beginning of it. Like every single
thing.
Well,
it's more like a two-hour tutorial. But then again, based on how many people hate the controls and I watch them play the game and they play it wrong, that tutorial was definitely needed and they just didn't listen to it.
Yeah, but why can't they just make it skippable for us with two functioning hands and a brain?
So you want Breath of the Wild, or you can just skip all the bullshit?
Yes.
Oh, that's a quote I will never forget.
So we had a couple of fan topics, but we'll save them maybe for another time. I'm going to keep them in this list, actually, in case we have a week where we're short. And then, so we're just going to go right to the last part, which is our favorite thing that happened in the past week. And I have something I've been itching to mention this entire podcast. I almost blurted it out when we were talking about the NX. Like, when it was said, oh, the NX will just come out, and no one's going to know about it. The PlayStation 4 Slim.
Yeah.
It leaked. There is an unboxing video for it. It's legit. It's real. People can get their hands on it. It seems like retailers are already getting it. And it was never announced. They didn't talk about it at E3. They didn't talk about it anywhere. Sony has never acknowledged this thing exists, and yet it's out in the wild.
Everybody did, didn't they? They said they're making a slim version, and it's not.
They said they're making the Neo. They acknowledged the Neo. They never acknowledged the Slim.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah.
There was a rumor for the Slim, but Sony themselves never even hinted at it. They just said, we have a PlayStation 4 Neo coming next year.
Yeah,
you're right.
And then they released like a bunch of different specs on it and talked about how it was going to be like super, you know, high, like 4K television, but they never said anything about a Slim.
Yeah, that's what makes the Slim. No one's surprised that a Slim exists because Sony's always done that.
Yeah.
But the fact that people have it and are unboxing it and are playing it and they never even announced it.
Do we know that that's not the Neo?
Yeah, it's not.
It's not. The box clearly says it's PlayStation.
It's the same like specs and everything. It's just a less bulky
system. It's a smaller version.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not even that much smaller. It's just a little bit smaller. But supposedly, I heard from people who have it that like they fixed, because one of the complaints with the PlayStation 4 is how loud it can get at times. And apparently that doesn't happen with the Slim. And they also, one of the big changes is the controller. Apparently they changed the sticks a little bit, which needed to be changed because it was too easy to break the skin on the sticks. And then
actually experienced that.
Yeah, and then they made the illuminated light that tells you what player you are. There's like a thin strip on the touchpad part that shows you what player you are. But a lot of people don't actually like that, but they did that. Anyways, that's like, that's just crazy to me because Sony has massive success with the PlayStation 4. How does the Slim go out into the wild without them mentioning it? Like, it's not in stores yet, but it's clearly coming out this year.
Well, somebody leaked something they weren't supposed to.
But it's like multiple people are like, yeah, I got this Slim thing. Like, what?
What?
Who? Like, they're not people that have, like, NDAs on or anything. It's like, how did you even get one?
Something went catastrophically wrong.
People are saying, based on the unboxing video, the manual's in Arabic, and they don't have, like, street dates for things in countries that use that language, apparently. So What they're saying is this console basically has been sent out to retailers, and that Sony, at the, they have like a thing going on in September when they're going to talk about the Neo. They were going to announce it there and be like, you can go buy it now, like today. And that's what they think the plan was, but because they sent it to these retailers that don't honor street dates or anything, that's how it got out. That's what they think.
Well,
but either way, that's crazy. Like, why would you even mention at E3 that this thing exists? Especially if it's coming out this year.
Well, one thing like, I can say for sure is that heads were rolling for that.
Oh yeah, someone's in trouble. Like this is bad. This is the this is comparable to me. Like the NX came out and got leaked entirely, and people have it and are showing videos of it, and we never even said it exists. Like what? Like, it's one thing if, like, a dev did it, because that dev's going to get fired if he does it. But this is, like, people in the public have it. It's, man. Anyway, that's my favorite thing of the last week, is somebody screwed up, and now we know this big announcement that's coming out this holiday.
Unless the Neo is the next big announcement that's coming out this holiday.
Yeah, I wonder if Sony, just to continue the trolling, now at this little press conference they have next month, are like, they're not even going to announce the Slim. They're just going to let it release now. They're not even going to say anything about it.
Yeah.
No, they will, because it's probably going to be like a $250 console or something.
Well, they're going to have to try and save face, especially after... Yeah. Sony's been having a real bad time recently. Not just their gaming division, but in
Well, their gaming division is rocking.
Well, I mean... Honestly, yeah, sure, it's doing better than most, but still, I have no idea what this PlayStation 4 you're talking about. All I have is a Bloodborne machine.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I will say that the PlayStation 4 has had a huge lack of exclusive games.
Nier. Nier's coming to PC.
Yeah. Like, it just got Uncharted 4, though.
Meh.
I know, I keep trying to think of all the Sony exclusives. Obviously, there was Killzone at launch.
Realm Reborn, Final Fantasy.
Yeah,
Realm Reborn.
Final Fantasy is going to come out to PC as well, if I remember correctly.
No, this isn't the same one. This isn't 15, I think.
Yeah, it's not, yeah. It's a different one. It's
14.
What I'm waiting for is The Last Guardian. If that ever comes out, then I'll buy a PlayStation 4.
Fun story. I was actually considering buying a PlayStation 3 on launch for Last Guardian because it was supposed to be a launch title.
I know. That's what we're seeing things about this game, but we're seeing the same stuff that we saw basically for the PlayStation 3.
Well, they have a release date, right?
What?
They have a release date now.
Supposedly.
It was announced in E3.
But... Yeah, this game, like, what they showed at E3 did not impress me, because it basically was a little bit of an extension on what the original PlayStation 3 showing was.
And there's absolutely no chance of that game being anywhere as good as people expect it to be, as people need it to be.
No. Like, Shadow of the Colossus was so amazing.
I'd say the PS4, though, like, if you think about it...
How long is the production of that game now? 10 years?
Something like that. I'm feeling... I don't think it's going to be as bad as, like, when Duke Nukem came out. After 10 years of development. I think it's just going to be okay. I'm afraid it's going to be like No Man's Sky. Where, not necessarily that they're lying to you, but the expectations for the game are for it to be as good, if not better, than Shadow of the Colossus. And it's just, it's okay.
Well, yeah, but, okay, Shadow of the Colossus was like, that's when you see, like, I compare that in the gaming world to, like, a Gone with the Wind or an original Ben-Hur. Like, that's one of those things that you don't get a lot of because it's such a beautiful classic, and it's really hard to recreate something like that. Like, you just saw the Ben-Hur movie came out, the remake, and it bombed. Like, it's done awful.
A lot of remakes do that.
It's hard to recreate that magic, so I'm not surprised. Sure. And I'm not necessarily looking at The Last Guardian to be better than Shadow of the Colossus, because I don't know if many games could live up to that.
Well, it's just like... People don't think Zelda games can live up to Ocarina of Time. That's just kind of a general consensus how people feel. Anyways, that was my favorite thing of the past week. PlayStation 4 Slim. Alfred, what's your favorite thing in the past week?
I've been playing a lot of No Man's Sky.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah, so sorry.
Well, see, it's it's been running well for me. I've been playing it on PC. There's a lot of gripes I have with the game, but I've logged about 25 hours in it since it came out. Now this is me going to like college now and like having actual responsibilities. But I've managed to log in a lot of time in the game. Not as much as other people have. I've also been playing so many other games. But it's like a they've compared it to, and this is a bad comparison. Like, it's bad for a No Man's Sky to be compared to this, but it's been compared to Pokemon Go in terms of, like, content, because, you know, the servers were down day one. Yeah. We expect all these great things from the game, and we get, like, the Reader's Digest version of the game instead. So, like,
I mean, there's been some PC fan mods have actually added, like, more content to the game than the game has.
But the problem is there's no, like, necessarily legit way to, like, there's a legitimate way. Like, I have Nexus mods on my computer so I can mod stuff like Left 4 Dead. But I don't necessarily want to mess with the No Man's Sky game file. And I say this with as much love for Hello Games as I can, but the game file is already so fragile as is that I feel like if I touch it with a mod, it's going to break. so I don't want to get anywhere near that. And like, there's some great stuff in the game. Like, it, you know, the exploration's fun, the different planets are fun, there's not nearly as, it's not as livable as you like, but there are definitely some problems. Like, I took a screenshot in it, and it's currently the background for the game on Steam, where it had trouble transitioning between two different terrains, so there's just these blocks of blur, and so it's like, there's a lot, it needs to be polished a lot.
It feels like a game that needed a lot more development time.
It needed a bigger team. It had, like,
what, 15
people, and it was, you know, it was initially going to be a PlayStation exclusive, and then it got on PC, and somehow not Xbox One. I'm still surprised by that.
It's like, we don't know how many planets there are. We don't know how many, like, I understand based on how the game works, but, like, you created the algorithms, so you should know the limits.
And I don't know if any of you guys have seen the Reddit post. There's a huge Reddit post about all the things that we are promised in No Man's Sky that we don't have. Like, the faction system is really useless. There's really no trading. The ships don't really matter. They just control a little differently.
You almost have to try to die.
Yeah, like, you have a shield. You have, like, 5 life meters that take a while to get knocked down. Then you have a life support system. It's almost harder. It's easier to die in space in a dogfight because the controls for the ship are so wonky.
Yeah, but it's also easy to run away from those fights too.
Kind of. You have to be near a planet because
That's true. Yep.
You can't start any of your pulse engines. You can only do the boost, which is significantly slower, because apparently the hostile scan or whatever it is jams the pulse.
Oh, of course.
It's just like really arbitrary things that don't necessarily make sense.
Yep.
It's still a great game, but there's a lot that could be improved and a lot that should be improved. And, like, a lot of it's not clear on how to do certain things.
I'm hoping... I think my hope for this game... Because I think it has the core of what needs to be there.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that it's like Splatoon. Splatoon came out, proved a really nice concept, but it didn't really... It didn't have all the content.
It's like Destiny.
Well, yeah, Destiny too. Although I think Destiny had more content in terms of like, not, I don't want to say more content. I don't know if any game has as much content as No Man's Sky. In terms of Destiny's progression, I think worked really well. And the difference with Destiny is a proper MMO.
But when it came out, it didn't get received as well as it is now.
No, yeah, that's true.
Like, it wasn't nearly as big.
The end game wasn't very fulfilling.
The story was...
Like,
the story
every
was,
MMO has that problem.
Well, yeah, but the story was really bad. Like, the game was really, like... You know, the online multiplayer was pretty bad. The Always Online was really bad. And then they fixed a lot of those problems when they released, like, the first big expansion for the game.
Yep.
And then they rebranded it. They rebranded it again. And so now it's, like, so much better than it used to be.
Oh, yeah. I haven't played it, but a buddy of mine who does told me that... If you were going to play the game, like, now is the time to get into it, because now it's, like, really, really good.
It's polished, it's nice, and that's what I see No Man's Sky getting to.
But that's what I'm hoping they get to. The thing that scares me Destiny got to that with a really big development team and a lot of money.
That's what I was going to say, is that they have a really small team.
Even Splatoon, I mean, it's backed by Nintendo. So if the dev team, say it's only 20 people, whatever, if they needed more time to do stuff, Nintendo was going to give them the time to do it and the money to do it, especially since Splatoon sold so well right away.
Yeah.
No Man's Sky, I think, is probably doing well sales-wise because it had a lot of pre-orders.
Well, it dropped a lot, though. Like, the sales have dropped exponentially.
Yeah, I basically heard it was people who pre-ordered got it, and then it didn't really, because of the poor reception, it didn't be like, oh, pre-orders are good, and then here's continual sales. Like, there's no continual sales.
Well, plus that, and people are getting refunds.
I was waiting for reviews, and all the reviews are telling me that the game's just okay at best.
Yeah.
Which tells me it's not worth my money if it's just okay. Especially for a game that you need to sink, you know, 50, 100 hours in.
Yeah.
To really get, you know, some nice stuff out. Like, yeah, you know, I heard the exploring's cool. Like, yeah, you discover a planet, you claim it, you get to name some creatures. Like, that's neat, but that novelty wears off fast.
Well, this is the second week of the title being out, and the sales have dropped 81% on UK charts alone.
That's
from VG247.
That's bad. See, Destiny didn't have that drop off.
And that's not noting the digital downloads, but still, this game was touted. It was released and announced at the Sony press conference.
There was so much expectations for this
game. Yeah, so this was a Sony-backed indie.
Sony was backing it, too.
Yeah. So,
like, that's what really made people confident. Like, oh, it's a nice indie game by a well-known company, Hello Games, but the fact that Sony backed it, just like Sony's backing Shenmue 3, you know, there's expectations because you have that money.
That's the biggest reason why I said, you know, Sony's having a big week. I mean, their gaming division had No Man's Sky, their movie division had Ghostbusters.
That was bad.
It's not good to be a Sony executive this week.
Well, Ghostbusters actually did well at the American box office.
It did well, but not well enough for them to keep pursuing the movie series.
Yeah, 70 million.
I don't know if they're going to a second Ghostbusters.
They lost about 70 million on that movie so far.
$70 million loss.
Yeah.
A lot of Sony's money, though, like a lot of their gaming division money, anyways, comes from their PlayStation 4, and that thing is still selling at high levels.
Yeah.
And as long as that sells, people are still buying the third-party games on it, and they make all those royalty fees. They don't really need the exclusive titles to make money from their game division.
I think
what Sony has actually learned through all of this. They built a system people want. They don't really have the exclusive games for it, but it doesn't need it because they just keep making money anyways from their gaming division. Their movie division is in shambles anyways.
I think that this is kind of like the reverse. And I love this movie, don't get me wrong. I love Suicide Squad. But you really see how, you know, not that this is kind of like apples and oranges, but you see how a big company with a big name director can make a movie that's maybe not, like, with all these we'll actually go with Ghostbusters instead. See since you brought it up, a large company making a big name movie that releases to, like, it had so much money poured into it. They had, like, so much advertising, they made a game that went along with it all did terribly. And they lost money on it.
The thing is, I watched that movie. I didn't think it was bad.
It wasn't. But it didn't get received as well.
Yeah, I think it built a bad reputation heading in. One, because the previews, thankfully, did not show really any of the good parts.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I was really worried the previews were supposedly the best parts, and they were not. So thank God that wasn't the case. So they didn't advertise it very well. And then on top of it,
but they spent a crap ton on advertising.
What sucked about this movie in particular isn't that it's all females and it's all stuff. It's that we were supposed to get the original Ghostbusters back together. Like, that was supposed to happen. And it didn't. And that kind of carries over into now we're replacing everything and rebooting the series. Like, that just, people weren't into that.
Well, and I think it's funny as a side note, Bill Murray said that he wasn't going to come back for the movie, which is why they didn't do one, but spoiler alert, he's in the movie.
Mm-hmm. It's so...
But even going back to, like, what I was going for is that you see how a big budget movie can still do terribly, and then you see how a small budget game can do well, and it's not necessarily always about the budget, and that's one of the things that you know, it's excusable to a point, but it seemed like, and somebody pointed this out too, is that with, you know, games that are bigger, like, okay, even a game like, let's pretend Uncharted 4 didn't do as well as it did. Mm-hmm. There was a lot promised in that game, but you still didn't hear a lot about what was actually in the game. Mm-hmm. And that's because bigger kinda companies like
Breath of the Wild.
Well, yeah, that's kind of like Sony and Santa Monica and all those other companies that they have are really good at PR. They know what they should say and know what yeah. they shouldn't say, because there's a lot of features that are being built into the game that may or may not make it in. And then we learn about those later on. Like, here are features, like even in Shadow of the Colossus, there were a bunch of Colossi or different mechanics that were taken out due to time constraints or quality assurance.
Yep, and the public didn't know about it.
Yeah, but I think that that's the problem that Sean Murray and Hello Games have, is they were like, well, we're going to put this in the game, we're going to put this in the game. Yeah,
they were too ambitious.
They were writing checks that their mouse couldn't catch.
It'd be different on the development side. They're like, oh yeah, like multiplayer, you can play with friends. We already have it in the game. But they're like,
we're going to have this and this and this and this.
They just said, we have a bunch of ideas, here they are. And then we couldn't execute them.
Well, the problem is that they didn't just not execute them, they made trailers with those ideas in the game.
Oh, it's bad.
And then released it. So
it's bad. It's almost Alien Colonial Marines bad. Except the game itself is better than Alien Colonial Marines was. But
yeah. It's still a good game. If you have $60 to spend and you're itching for a game that's like,
Your time.
Yeah. No Man's Sky is great. Yeah.
Just go find a free copy of World of Warcraft and spend $15 to activate it.
But I would still wait. If you're a little hesitant, wait for the game to get better. Because they say they're ushering out new updates this week for the game that's supposed to make gamers happier.
Do what most people should do with Destiny. Wait until the content's complete. People should have did it with Splatoon 2. Like, wait until there's a bunch of content.
Yeah.
The game feels complete. Demir, we haven't talked to you quick. We got a couple minutes left. What's your favorite thing from this past week?
Well, to tell you, it's probably this podcast. And there is a specific reason. Oh. There's a specific reason for that. You know, a couple of reasons, really. And, you know, I haven't been in one of these for years. I haven't been involved with Zelda Informer for a very long time due to a lot of things. You know, I've gotten busy. You know, we've been kids when we started the site. I was 16 years old. And, you know, a lot of stuff happened since then. College, I got married and, you know, got a job.
Sure.
So you can't really, you know, focus on this kind of work full time.
Yeah.
The last big thing I did was the Skyward Sword tutorial, walkthrough that I wrote, and the videos that I recorded for that. That I remember that well. But something happened recently, and, you know, I'm very happy that it did. And the specific thing is... Well, I'm not sure how to phrase this properly, but, you know, I started getting a bunch of freelance work, and I started making a good living for myself in the past few months. And what happened is, since I got a lot more disposable income, I went, for the first time in my life, I opened up, you know, Amazon, eBay, and, you know, let's buy some shit for drawers, just so I can put something on my shelf. And, you know, I'm looking right now at my boxed, fully, brand new Ocarina of Time N64 version with the instruction manual and everything. I have the Majora's Mask, you know, special edition, the Hyrule Warriors with the golden watch thingy special edition.
If you're feeling like... generous and you want to give that to someone?
Yeah, unfortunately.
No, God.
So, and you know, I'm waiting, it's still, it's shipped, and I'm waiting for it to arrive. It's Link to the Past box, brand new, with a map, with the original 1992 map in it.
Oh, those are worth a lot.
Yeah, and you know, I got the Wind Waker Collector's Edition with the Ganondorf figure, and all of that, and I've been getting so much more into the point being that when I was looking what to buy, so I wasn't looking for specifically Zelda things, but I was always coming back to them, and those looked the most attractive things to me. I got some Metroid games as well, but it kind of reaffirmed to me just how much I love the series, and how if I could, you know, wind time back, you know, 10 years to be a unemployed 16-year-old again with all the time in the world on my hands, you know, I would. Again, love to write for the site and do work and all of that stuff. But, yeah.
shove Wiimotes up your nose.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah, I remember that. Oh, God.
I'll leave that alone because it brings up a dark part of our past.
Yeah.
Before we end.
It is funny, though. The video is still on YouTube.
Oh, God.
If people want to look it up, good luck. You don't have access anymore.
Oh, God. I'm going to need to bug someone for that, Nate.
And it's funny, our YouTube channel is actually getting more active and gaining more subscribers. Thank you for everyone who views this podcast, has been viewing the little clips of Breath of the Wild footage we've been putting up from Nintendo. I am happy to announce that kind of at the end of this podcast, so if you made it this far, thank you. We are going to have a brand new video feature coming for our YouTube people. We have a new video guy on board who is going to be creating Zelda Theory videos. So you can look forward to those kind of coming every other week. I think the first one's supposed to hit like next week, I think. So I actually have to get hold of my. I forgot to write down on my whiteboard the day I'm supposed to contact him about the video. So we'll see. But that's awesome. I'm trying to expand what we do here, so you're not just getting this podcast beaten to your head. Although this podcast is pretty awesome.
Yep.
All right, well, thank you. That's going to wrap it up. So thank you so much for joining us this week. You can follow Zelda Informer on all our social media channels. Just type in Zelda Informer either as one word or as two. It'll pop up for you either way. You can subscribe to us on YouTube. That's where the video version of our podcast is at. You can subscribe to us on Podbean. That's where we publish the audio version. Or on SoundCloud. We also post our audio-only version there. Alfred, where can they follow you?
At Full Metal Alfie on Twitter. And
Full Metal Alfie.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that's my Twitter.
Yeah, if you're watching the video version, his Twitter handle is in the video version. So.
Also, in case anyone was interested, Nintendo sold their majority stake in the Seattle Mariners for $661 million yesterday, I think.
Yep.
Which is a lot of money.
I have a feeling that this is going to help them majorly with their finances, as they have nothing coming out this holiday. But
yeah.
It was a very smart time to sell. Let's put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to make their end of year reporting look very nice. Demir,
yes.
Do you want people following you anywhere?
I don't have any sort of social media account anymore.
Good man. The best people out there with the best jobs making the most money stay off of social media.
No, you know, it's actually, I don't have time. And I hate those people.
Oh, exactly. People who make lots of money don't have time.
No, I hate most people as well. And that's a bigger
I know, you hate me a lot.
Yeah, you're my least favorite.
Favorite. But I am a favorite, see?
Yeah,
out of all of his favorites, you're the least favorite.
Appropriate property to call you. So my least favorite, what? I don't know, Saitama.
Oh, boy. All right, well, thanks everyone for joining us on this podcast. If Demir ever figures out what to call me, we'll put it in. We'll edit it in later.
I do have a word, but we're going to have to wait until we're offline.
All right. Well, thanks everyone for listening. We will see you next week.
Yeah.
Bye.